I don't know why, but always when you pick him up like that, he just looks like a fat little cat man to me. And like, he's just the most pathetic thing every time. Look at him. Can't have enough.
Hello, welcome to the QuackCast. This is QuackCast number 534. I'm Ozan Ocean, and with me is Baines, Tarns, and Pit Face.
Hello.
Hello.
Oh, hello, hello, hello. This week we're talking about the idea of biting off more than you can chew, you know, sort of taking on a project that's a bit beyond your ability to tackle. And what happens when that happens? You know, whether you keep on struggling on regardless and, you know, meeting the challenge, or whether you give it up, or whether you try and meet the challenge and you produce something half-assed. There's a lot of different results from this kind of thing. But before we do that, I've got to bring up the featured comic. Featured comic this week, Quiet Agoxe featured Cosmic Safari. So, Quiet, tell us about Cosmic Safari.
Hello, this is Quiet Agoxe, and the feature I've selected for this week is Cosmic Safari by Frenemy, and it is rated E for everyone. The most important rule when going on a cosmic safari is to not let hunger take over. Hopefully a quirky group of fantastical friends ready to go on an adventure heeds this advice when an ominous group of young shadows approaches asking for assistance in rescuing their mother from a scientist. This group of keepers is about to go on a quest in the face of panic. The comic story is written and told through full-colored pages. The art and coloring is psychedelic. The font has an original handwritten look and feel that complements the illustrations. Go on a trip to find Spencer the biologist and read Cosmic Safari by Frenemy, rated E.
And that was Cosmic Safari. Okay, so next up we have the featured music. This week Gilmore's has given us a theme to a little comic called Cosmic Safari. Oh my god, I was telling these guys that the theme that, you know, they would have known that this comic sounded familiar because we'd done a theme to it last week. Well, we hadn't. We're doing it this week. So, I don't know why it sounds familiar, guys. I was talking out of my backside.
I think we're all off our vacation. Because that was just a whole big, like, oh, I've heard that before. We were talking about that before. That was really weird. Because we were all in agreement, pretty much.
Yeah. It never happened. It's a psychic safari for all of us. So, Cosmic Safari has gotten into our brains and mixed our heads up. It's a very freaky, surreal-looking comic, so no wonder it lends itself to that. The music that Gumwallis has given us, though, it's a trip through the wilderness of the vast galaxy along beautifully colored nebula filaments, past rings encircling gas giants, and through the tails of comets. This Jean-Michel Jarre meets a small remote control car. It's sort of a really beautiful piece of music. So take it away, Gumwallis, with Cosmic Safari by Frenemy, rated E.
And Gun Wallace, by the way, update all of your songs on your page, please.
Oh.
that was our featured music, Cosmic Safari. What a little coincidence there. Both the featured music and the featured comic are both Cosmic Safari, which is a comic by Frenemy, and it's rated E for everyone. Alright, next up, we're chatting about biting off more than we can chew. So this topic hit me because I was thinking, I think we were actually talking about it last week. We were having a chat about, you know, directors who have done this. And, you know, my favorite example is, of course, J.J. Abrams with the Star Wars sequels. And just a writer that wasn't equipped to handle epic sci-fi. Because that's, epic sci-fi is a big sort of project to take on, and unless you've got a bit of experience, you know, a lot of experience, writing experience, and you're really like top hot shit, then you really can't do a good job at it. James Cameron, the same thing, who is a very accomplished director and writer in his own right, but epic sci-fi is just slightly beyond what he could handle. If you've watched that film, you'll know it's a fun action film, but there's a lot of problems with it. But bringing it back to us as comic writers, we've all run into this issue. We talked about it in the Patreon video. Me with my pinky TA, I've had stories that I couldn't really finish properly because spit off more than I could chew. They were just too big a project for me to handle, and when I've tried to write a proper ending for the story, it's just I ran out of steam because it was just too big a thing. I've also started little comics, like I started one called Pink Skin, which is like a comedy version of Pinky TA, and I just bit off more than I could chew. I just couldn't handle the demands of making it funny and jokes and stuff like that. Was really, really bloody hard, because comedy is very, very hard to write. And I also was doing a ghost story, and it was just I thought I could do it because the idea sounded so fun, but when I just approached the idea, it was just beyond what I could do. So anyway, that's my experience with it. What about you guys?
Well, actually, you know, I hate to say this before I could actually put actions behind my words, but I've started working on Brave Resistance again, and I feel a lot more ready to do so now. Hey. After what, like a 3-year hiatus? I'm so sorry. But to be honest, I always felt a little bit out of my element with the art. Not that I think it was necessarily bad or anything like that, but I always just kind of felt I wasn't polished enough, or where I personally wanted to be for the story. But now I'm working on it again, and I feel a confidence and a more natural relation with it as I'm drawing it than I did before. So especially looking at some of my art I had done before, again, not saying that I think it's bad, but compared to what I can do now, I feel like a few more things have fallen into place. My understanding has been sharpened a little bit, and I can do it a little bit more justice in terms of the line work and stuff. So,
okay.
I just have to say that
that's interesting.
It's going to be awesome. It was already awesome. I always loved everything she drew. But now I'm even more excited for it. And yeah, I can absolutely understand where she's coming from, even though for me it has always been perfect. Thank you. That was all I wanted to say.
Oh, thank you, Ted.
But I'm glad you can understand, though, you know. I mean, sometimes I think for projects, if you don't feel comfortable with it, that's telling you something. Not necessarily that you're not supposed to do that project, but maybe you need to study a little bit more, you know, follow up on the questions you have, or like, what isn't clicking on it? So that way, if you do find it's worthwhile down the line, if it's something you keep on coming back to, it's something you keep on thinking about, you can sharpen up on those skills in the meantime, and you'll get there eventually to where you're comfortable with it.
Oh yeah, I like that. That you've actually, you know, made some progress in the meantime. That you now you can tackle something that you felt you bit off more than you can chew. That's encouraging. I remember one of the things with Pinky TA was that I sort of vowed to myself that I would never try and get stuck in my comfort zone. So if there was a scene that I would think, oh my god, no, that's too hard, I'll come up with a simpler way of doing it. I always had this idea of nothing is ever too big for me to chew, you know? So if I'm thinking, okay, I want this scene to take place on a huge battleship, and I want like an aerial perspective, and I want like ocean and stuff like that, my idea was always, okay, I've conceived the idea and that's what I want to do, so now I have to work out how to do it. And I would go forward regardless, so I wouldn't take the easy way out. So that was my thing. And that's fair enough with artwork, because I specialize in artwork and I've been doing that for years. But in story, that's another thing. That takes a whole set of other skills, and I was not up to the task when it came to tackling things that you know, were too big for me. So there you are. That took me a bit of more practice and learning to get better. I'm still not that good, but I'm better than I was. Anyway, sorry, Baines, were you going to say something?
I don't think so, no. Just listening.
Oh. Okay. I thought someone was about to say something, and I...
Not that I know of. riveting podcast. No, but I think those things are good to hear, though. You know, mm-hmm. I think a lot of times as creators, we kind of put ourselves on islands, right? Where we get so kind of consumed by our experiences and what we don't know, and we're our toughest critics, you know? And it's so easy to let that consume you sometimes. But when you can hear that it really truly does happen to pretty much everybody else, it feels like it's something that can be fixed, you know, something, it's a phase, and it can get better. But sometimes that also requires being truthful about yourself with things, you know. Maybe you're very attached to a certain kind of style you have, but that style isn't super fitted to the story that you're visualizing, you know, and you might try to force that style to work in that story, but you can feel that it's not happening quite right. That's a time when you have to be truthful to yourself, and realize you might have to put in some hard work and be a little bit more negotiable to make it work, to make that vision actually come true. And that can be really difficult, because we put a lot of ourselves into our styles and the way we do things. So when you have to change it for a story, it feels kind of like you're moving a mountain, or like you're kind of learning how to walk again, you know?
Yeah. Very nice. So
probably a good thing in a way to run into this. It sort of means that, I mean, like you said, it's sort of probably a super common experience. If you're making stuff in an ongoing way, like, you're going to run into this, you know, like, it's just not ready for that idea. Or if art is your struggle, like, I'm just not quite there yet. Like, I can't really make that happen. I've had that on both sides. Like, I'm not really capable of drawing that. I might have to just abandon it. or if it's like a story that's too big in my series to do yet. Like I've got stuff that's been backburnered, that was backburnered for years, and then I finally did it. And I've got other stuff now that's been backburnered for a long time. Eventually, I'll be ready to do it. You just kind of have to let it percolate and let the characters get to that point. And you know, when it's the right time and you're able to figure out the bones of the story better, like it'll happen, you know.
Yeah.
Down the road, like when it's time.
Yeah.
Good. I run into it, actually, now that I'm thinking about this, I run into it on news posts. Like, I do a news post every week on the Duck. And I run into it all the time. Like, I have an idea. I'm like, oh, that's a cool little... I'd like to make that little point, because that matters to me, and, like, maybe that would matter to somebody else. And then I start writing it, and I just realize, okay, topic is way bigger than I thought it was. Like, to cover any... Like, even this portion of it is just, like, it's just so huge, so... Sometimes I awkwardly just kind of cut myself off, and sometimes I just delete it.
Well, you should say something about saving it for later, for when you can approach it.
Yeah, sometimes that is how it goes. Yeah, just kind of wait until I can figure out the right framework for it or whatever.
He deletes it, and then he like burns his computer in a bonfire and like buries the ashes.
I will say there's less emotion to that, although there's some pressure because there's a deadline, but with stories and comics and stuff, there's more emotion to it. It's more like kind of frustrating because you really wanted to make something happen with your characters, you know, mm-hmm. certain things you were really excited about.
Yeah.
You know, with a news post, it's like nobody knows anything about what I was going to write, you know, whereas people know the characters. Whoever reads your comic knows your characters, and it's like, I really wanted them to see this.
Yeah.
You know, what am I talking about? Anyway, whatever.
Yeah, news posts are interesting. I've done a few, and it's been like that. Like I've thought, oh my god, this topic is such an interesting thing, and then you actually approach it and think, geez, this is way more complicated and hard than I ever imagined. I just quit.
Yeah.
Sometimes that is a good solution to things. I mean, it's brave and it's great to power on and continue and maybe improve your skills and improve, you know, and achieve something great in spite of it. But sometimes it's just too much of a struggle and it's just going to grind you down into nothing to keep on with this thing. So sometimes it's just better to cut it loose. Cut your losses and go with a simpler thing. So the moral of the story is you don't have to kill yourself to produce a piece of work.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, dying would greatly inhibit your ability to produce content. So
true.
Well, yeah, and actually, the thing is, if you're doing that, if you're like stressing over and having art blocks and, you know, like writer's blocks and all this kind of stuff, you're not producing other things that you could much more easily be doing. So it does sort of take away from your ability to produce. So you get to a point of, what is it, diminishing returns or... Yeah, diminishing returns, I suppose. So sometimes you do have to cut your losses and go back to stuff that's more creatively productive. That's just
how it is.
You can always come back to it later.
Yeah.
Unless you mm-hmm. like Banes and you burn your computer and scatter the ashes.
And salt the earth.
Exactly. Nuke the whole country where the computer was residing. Oh, jeez. Yeah. We go to extremes on this QuackCast. It's just how it is. You have to.
I had this scene, I probably talked about this before, but I had a scene in mind for an issue of Typical Strange where it's sort of like their version, so it's like a comedy version of a kind of a spy intrigue adventure kind of thing. And it was going to end with a like a sequence of a character tied to a chair on a rooftop, and like a gunfight breaks out and his chair falls backwards, but he's stuck in like the rebar or something on the edge of the roof. And so he's hanging there in his chair. And I had this in my mind for years. I found notes going all the way back to when I first started posting comics.
Wow.
Like the early pages of Typical Strange, like I had notes from way back then for this future idea. And a lot of things in that story were more than I could chew. There was like sort of a relationship between one of my characters and a new character, this agent, and I wanted the sort of their association to be a certain way, but it was hard to figure out. And then this final scene on the rooftop was like, I remember I would set up toys once in a while over the years together to figure out like where everything would be and how it would all work and how I would draw it, because drawing it was going to be so hard for me. And I like, it was multiple years of like having this in mind, and like every once in a while I'd sort of take it out and like do some notes on it and plan it out. And it took a super long time. I sometimes wondered, like, I wonder if I'll ever do this. And eventually I did, and that story, it's a few years ago now that I did that story, and a lot of people, like, it got great, like people really liked it, the commenters, like it got sort of good reviews kind of thing, maybe partly because of all that groundwork and all that preparation. And I did end on the rooftop. I did that whole thing. Like, it took so long to get to the point where I actually did it. I was like, I can't believe I'm actually doing this.
Yeah, it's very effective. Awesome. I remember that.
And it looks very simple. It's drawn the way I draw. It's like super simple and stuff.
Yeah.
But it worked. And the amount of planning it took, I'm sure, is not apparent at all. It's a kind of funny.
It's a damn good little story.
Eventually it's time. We'll get there.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah. And it can be so rewarding though when you do get to that part, doesn't it? The part that you've been planning and battling with in your head, and but that you've been thinking about ever since you conceive the story, you know, sometimes even before it, because sometimes these scenes that we come up with in our head, you know, they're the reason why we end up building a narrative or drawing a picture about something.
Mm-hmm.
But when you finally get to that point, that big centerpiece, and kind of look back at the way you came, it feels powerful, doesn't it? You're like, holy shit, I'm here. I'm doing it. You know, I came through with the goddamn thing. I didn't just die on the side of the road.
Yeah.
So many things, you know.
It's pressure too, because, you know, webcomics, I think most of us, and definitely I'm like finishing and posting pages before the new pages are done. And in this case, I did some tests, and I kind of knew what I was doing, I think. Some of those pages might have been drawn ahead just to make sure, but like there is pressure as you're getting there. It's like, oh man, like we're getting close to those pages. Like,
yeah.
Kind of set it up properly and all that kind of stuff.
It's exciting, but you also don't want to shit the bed.
Yeah. After all that time, it's like, oh my God, I really hope this works with someone.
Oh yeah. That's a constant struggle. The whole biting off more than you can chew thing. It's I mean, we've talked.
And I've had the opposite too, where I had something in mind and like I was setting up like a certain kind of emotional tone of an ending. And it didn't like this, like, and people, like readers were getting excited, I could tell, and I was excited. And then the ending didn't quite fly. I could just feel it. I was like, I wasn't quite there. I didn't give it enough time in my own mind to figure it out, like what it should be, and just kind of a little limp at the end.
Would you ever revisit that? Like go back and redo it? Because, I mean, that's the magic of posting things on the internet. We can change them and alter them and
It's a good question. I thought about it. I'm like, I should take those last few pages and just do a new version of them But I mean, you know, people who are reading the comic, the few, I haven't posted pages in months, by the way, so this maybe is irrelevant, but at the moment, but I don't know if anyone would see it, you know, if I did a new version.
Oh, yeah.
You don't have all the build up, like the 50 pages leading up to it. So maybe, but I'm not really sure.
Yeah. Possibly,
it might be worth it.
It's up to you. I mean, your degree of satisfaction.
That's a good question. I'm not really sure.
So what about in creative properties that you've seen, like media that you've consumed, where you've seen, I mean, we talked about the Star Wars sequels and Avatar, but have you seen any other examples where the creators clearly bit off more than they can chew and produce something half-assed?
Avatar: The Last Airbender by Shyamalan
is the best
example, and I really do think that the guy bit off a lot more than he could chew, because I don't think he knew what he was getting into as much as he claimed, and he didn't understand the material at all. On the other hand, you see him really trying to stick to the original material, like all the designs and everything. But on the other hand, he misses the mark so much. Like, he doesn't understand the essence, the logic, the feel of this particular world.
Hmm.
So, yeah, I don't think that he was out to ruin it. He just didn't know what he was getting into, and he wasn't actually, I don't know, he didn't have enough advisors, I guess. I don't know what happened.
And he wasn't equipped to deal with this
particular project, you know, translating this great epic animated story into a full-length feature film. Just was beyond.
That happens with a lot of adaptations. Video game movies suffer from it quite a lot.
Yeah, they do. Those certain writers, they bite off more than they can chew. It's a common problem. Speaking of video games, Mass Effect 3, which is quite a famous game. The creators, BioWare, I think, yeah. So that was meant to be like there were three of these games, Mass Effect 1, Mass Effect 2, Mass Effect 3, and they were always meant to be a trilogy, and they came out over the course of like maybe 10 years or something like this. This was an eagerly awaited series, and it was meant to be that, you know, your choices directed how the story would go, because it's a role-playing game. But when it finally came to the end of the last game, all your choices did was just change the color of the end screen. It was so freaking lame.
No,
there was almost like no difference, and the choices you'd make in the previous games didn't have any effect on the last game whatsoever. The only thing that affected the ending in the last game was the choices you made in the last game. And yeah, like I say, it was just a different color, so it was so pathetic. And they tried to justify it, saying, yeah, but you don't understand. But yeah, it was they ran out of money, and they ran out of time, and they just did a half-assed end. So that's what happens. It was a classic case of biting off more than you can chew. So yeah, I've had this in other projects too. Like when I was I didn't bite off more than I could chew, but it was because when I was making my 18th century white suit with the, you know, tricorn hat with the feathers in it and a frock coat and all that. I had this idea of that I might be biting off more than I could chew. So I approached the whole project thinking of, okay, what are the minimum things I can get away with in order to have this looking like a really cool looking, you know, suit, like 18th century suit. What are the minimum things? Okay, so coat. Got to do the coat. That has to be the minimum. And okay, so the coat, you need a waistcoat and you also need trousers. So those are the new minimums. So I have to get up to there. So I always had an out point. If I couldn't, you know, if I was biting off more than I could chew, if I couldn't finish it in the time, I would still have stuff finished enough that it would still work. And I approached the whole thing that way. And in the end, I had it like fully complete. Like I had, you know, the covered hat with the feathers. I even had shoes that matched. I even had boots in the end that matched, because I approached the whole thing like step by step. So sometimes that's got to be the way you approach stuff. You've got to like do it step by step. And if ever you come to a spot that you can't complete, you've still got an out. You've still got it completed enough that it can still work regardless of the rest of the things that you couldn't, you know, contribute to it. So that's a good way of doing it. Sometimes you don't need to complete the whole project in order to have a something that's serviceable. It's like in films, they don't have to, you know, to have these exciting chase scenes and the scene of the hero scaling the giant monument. You can sort of, you know, get away with the project being 75% complete and still be an awesome job if you've structured it well enough that you've, you know, you've taken this into consideration, and then you can come out of it with still a great piece of work, rather than, you know, cobbling together crap and just justifying it at the end. Oh yeah, I meant to do it this way, you know, that kind of bullshit.
Yeah. It seems easier to pull it off too if you have your main idea in mind. You're aware of what it is you're trying to do, whether you're trying to convey some sort of idea or you want this big, amazing, visually stunning thing or what it is. Just kind of be aware of what it is that you're trying to work towards. I think once we kind of lose that navigation, which can happen quite easily sometimes, that's when we kind of tumble down the hill.
Yeah, that's a good point. You know, have the big picture in mind, but not have the end goal in mind. Yeah, not just the big picture, because if you got the big picture in mind, you can, that can swamp you. And you can think, yeah, oh my God, how am I ever going to approach this? How am I ever going to finish it? But if you do have that end goal in mind, then you know what you want to reach for. So then you know, you know, a good way of sort of finishing it, or at least, you know, getting out before the whole thing's finished and still have it looking pretty good.
Yeah, because, and you just go step by step, like you had said before too, you know, both of those things. It's a good way not to overwhelm yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Like you break off little pieces. That's how I tackle, like Baines was telling us a while ago about the news post, the things that he's done, and how sometimes that can be a biting off more than you can chew thing because the subject's a bit too big. And that also goes back to like essays at university or school, you know, those kind of things are biting off more than you can chew. And my method of tackling those now is like, I suppose, a classic essay thing where you you write up your end conclusion that you want to get to, and you also write off like the 5 or 6 points that you want to approach and how you want to approach and the certain things you want to mention. And then you have your intro where you mention all those things, and then you like tackle all the points that you wanted to tackle, and then you have your conclusion. So you've got a structure that you can work around that makes it a bit more.
Absolutely. And it's all the better when you allow yourself the time for editing as well. Because that helps you kind of hammer all those parts together. And if you're like, you know, you take the example of writing the thesis, that's something that I got to do when I was doing my master's, and we very much did it the way that you were just talking about, you know, you have the main point, but you have kind of the roadmap you want to go on to get there, and bit by bit you fill it in and go back and edit it, then fill it in some more, and you just kind of keep on hammering the little bits and pieces into shape bit by bit. And it helps it not to be overwhelming, because there is a lot of work to do. But stories are, you know, they're basically a thesis. They're the same sort of thing. You have the main idea, then you have ways that you kind of support it, ways that you tell the story. And that can be really draining sometimes, especially when it's something you just want to put your whole heart to. It's something you just want to get right, you know. And that's when editing, it just means so much to be able to build it and then go back and alter it as necessary, instead of just, you know, doing what I usually do. And that's just, you know, throwing it up there as it comes along. But with Inhabitants, Inhabitants is far different than, say, Blitzov, and to a big extent Putrid Meat, because I am taking a lot more time to parse things out and really kind of dig into them the way I want. And that requires editing. So, which is a big reason why I already started Inhabitants over once, because I hadn't taken the time to really figure it out. I wanted to get to the points I'm working towards too quickly. So I just kind of slapped on an intro, and that wasn't working. I wanted to step backwards and tell more of the story. And now that I've been able to do that, yeah, it's taking a lot longer to get to the main part. We're still in kind of like a prelude or like a backstory. But I'm so glad that I'm doing it, because it feels far more complete to me. And in the responses I see from people, it seems that it is. So,
yeah, it's a pretty amazing piece of work. Definitely recommend Inhabitants, The Inhabitants. It is very nicely structured.
Thank you.
There are a few ways of writing. You know, you can approach a story in a straight linear fashion, and that works for some people, and that's fine if it does. And it's not dependent on length either, because, you know, some people can do really short stories, making them highly structured, and really, really long stories, making them totally linear. Linear in their process. What I mean there is you don't plan it out, you just sort of go, yeah, it was dark and stormy night, and then this happened, and this happened, and then you come to an ending. But it's easier to fail if you're going to do it that way, because it's very easy to sort of lose your way when you're forging from one spot to another. It's incredibly easy to just run out of steam. So, yeah. But this isn't a QuackCast about writing structure.
But we're damn well gonna make it one.
Yes. It does help. It does.
In a way, it can be. Like, I know I have a sort of an epic in mind and in my comic. Eventually, maybe it'll all happen. But it's been very helpful to think of bites, like sort of bite-sized pieces to separate into individual stories. Like, maybe the beginnings of it have already happened in the comic, actually. But like looking ahead, I'm like, maybe like one story is just this. It's this little section, a little hint of things, and like a little adventure, a regular comic length, a 30 pager, 25 pager. And then I'll go back to normal, sort of more standard stories for an issue or two, and then do the next bite-sized piece where like things maybe go a little deeper, they get a little bigger, you see a different... Like, so I've thought about like this epic idea, but like it could be broken into different little standalone stories that have ongoing arcs, you know? So structure is part of the whole idea of kind of biting and chewing and all that stuff we're talking about.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, and you know, that goes...
Chew my fingernails while I'm thinking of ideas.
Precisely, you know, and if you do ever bite off more than you can chew, just maybe spit it out and cut it up into little pieces, and then you can.
I took off a half a finger. Luckily, I'm left-handed, so I can keep working.
Oh dear, dearie me!
Screaming, yeah,
screaming. I bit off more than I could chew with this QuackCast tonight because I'm so freaking tired.
It's not our most exhilarating work, is it?
I'm dying. Okay. Well, I think on that note, we'll wrap this up. This is, biting off more than you could chew. Maybe people could tell us about when they've bitten off more than they could chew, or when they think they've seen, you know, a movie writer, a game producer, or a book writer.
Yeah.
Bite off more than they could chew, and, you know, just flub that landing, which happens. I'm sure you've seen many examples of this. All right, thank you very much for being part of QuackCast number 534.
Bye. Thanks, y'all.
Thank you.
In the dead of night, I'll see your traffic cone and raise you street sign, bitch.